Welcome to the Northampton Mayor's Forum. We have with us on our panel Mayor David Narkiewicz and former mayors Harry Chapman, who was the mayor of Northampton from 1977 to 79, David Musante, the mayor from 1979 to 1991, Mary Ford, who occupied the Oval Office, the center office, the one without the window. I have been there, 1991 to 1999. Clare Higgins, who was the mayor of Northampton from 1999 to 2011, and our present mayor, David Narkiewicz, who has been the mayor since 2011. I'm Bill Newman. I'm joined on our panel of questioners today with Bob Flaherty. He is the WHMP morning show host and longtime Daily Hampshire Gazette editor, Stan Moulton. We are broadcasting live from the Northampton Senior Center. We want to thank Pat Goggins so much for putting this together, and we want to remember the passing of two great citizens of Northampton who passed recently, former Mayor Sean Dunphy and David Kramer. And we want to thank them and remember them for all their contributions to the city and to our community. If you'd like to join our discussion, we are here at the Senior Center. There's a microphone. You're welcome to come and pose your question or to write us a note of a question you have, and we'll try to weave it into the conversation. Or those listening, call us at 586-7140, and we will try to have your question texted over to us, and we will try to ask it indeed.
And I wanted to bring up NCTV, who is co-producing our broadcast this morning, Bill.
Thank you. Many of you know, at the beginning of our show, we often have a fish wrap. Today's newspaper is tomorrow's fish wrap. And on the front page of the Daily Hampshire Gazette today, Coolidge's Christmas Connection, 30th President Gets Tree Ornament Honor. Really, a big article and a well-written article indeed. With the push of a button on December 24, 1923, President Calvin Coolidge brought the first national Christmas tree to light, illuminating 2,500 electric bulbs. And he has his own Christmas tree ornament now. It's a nostalgia piece. Calvin Coolidge not only has a bridge named after him, but an ornament at the White House. Can you imagine? I am interested to know from all of our former mayors what they have been doing since they left the office. And so I'd like to start out by asking them that, if I might. We know, of course, that Calvin Coolidge really was kind of a rate breaker in a lot of ways, but he did go on from the mayoral office in Northampton. He became a state senator, state senate president. He became the lieutenant governor, and then the vice president of the United States, and then president of the United States. And so I'd like to find out how that has set precedent for all of you. So could you tell us what you've been doing since you left the office, President Clare Higgins?
I'm on the exact same career path.
How's that going?
it's going really well. I'm leaving for New Hampshire.
So tell us what you have been doing.
When I left City Hall, I took the job as Executive Director of Community Action, which is the anti-poverty agency for Franklin and Hampshire counties. We run Head Start, fuel assistance, the WIC program, food pantries, do homelessness prevention, information referral, financial counseling. We do a whole bushel basket of services that help people living with low incomes, helping them find opportunity.
Could you get into the microphone just a little bit closer, please?
He told me to move away, and you're telling me, okay, I'll manage this. See, I've been away from the public spotlight for so long. So really working to create community and to create opportunity for people living with low and moderate incomes.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate the work. And let me turn to President Harry Chapman. Where have you been? What are you doing? I know you took your passport and you came here from Texas. How'd that work out?
It's a different country. There's no question about that. Slightly different politics in Texas as there is in Massachusetts. Left office and actually moved to Indiana with an insurance company and grew in that position to run their group department. Moved to Texas and started another company. I classify myself more as an entrepreneur these days, but built a few companies, sold them. Some of them didn't work out too well, but the largest, Chapman Shuey, grew to be a national firm with 33 offices around the country and six business units. Still associated with that. I enjoy Texas. God's blessed.
We're not going to hold that against you.
Yes. it's very entrepreneurial. God has blessed us in many ways, and so you learn, from that too much to those that have given much, much is expected. So we've tried to get very, continue to be very strong in our faith, and it's always fun to come back to Northampton. One thing I do will say, you know, all these mayors, with the exception of David, have been here, were there for multiple years as mayor. I mean, I was a short timer. I was 2 years. I guess I'll probably be the last person ever elected to only serve 2 years as the mayor of the city. And then, of course, Dave, I'm sure he at least has four, but I'm sure you want to be more than one term. But it's
we'll get to that in due course, really. Trust us. I mean, I guess the next question shouldn't be, what are you doing when you leave office, Mayor Narkiewicz? And we'll get to that in just a sec. But Mary Ford, tell us what you've been doing since you left the office.
I went looking for jobs in fields that I thought were interesting and actually got two offers on the same day, one to go to work for one of the reform mayors down in D.C. and the other for an organization in Greater Boston that dealt with kids in their after school hours, before school hours, their time out of school and what those needs are, and really a national leader. That was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. And then I found out that the kind of sharp elbows in the Boston area was not my style at all. And that really helps me reflect back on my time in Northampton. I went from there to working on affordable housing with a big Boston organization, and loved that as well, and took my leave realizing that over the long term that wasn't going to be a good fit. So back to Western Massachusetts, and I worked primarily in the field of health and public health for community health centers.
Now that you're back, are you going to run again?
No.
A definitive question with a definitive answer. Let me turn from Mayor Mary Ford to Mayor Dave Musante. Dave, I know that after you left the office, you not only worked for various organizations, you literally worked around the world. Tell our listeners who may not have kept track with what of your comings and goings, what you were doing.
Well, I'd like to say I haven't felt this good since November of 1979 when I knocked off Harry Chapman, which contributed to his short stint as mayor.
Things are going well here at the Senior Center this morning.
After leaving the mayor's job, I was appointed county administrator for Hampshire County for about almost a year. Waiting for an assignment with the Peace Corps, and my wife and I went into the Peace Corps to Russia, and we spent 3.5 years in Russia and Kyrgyzstan, Peace Corps and USAID positions. Came back, and she took a job at Rice University in Houston, and I went.
What's with all you people going to Texas?
I don't know.
What is this career path? Rumor, Northampton to Texas.
Rumor had
Harry, you were a trailblazer.
Rumor had it Davey that Crockett. Harry was doing so well that I forgot to get out. So I went to umpiring school down there and did 160 games my first summer and stayed at that. And then following my wife, she took a job at Cal State Fullerton, and we've been there now for 14 years. I served on the Planning Commission there for 8 years and been very active in the Osher Lifelong Learning Program. We've got 1,700 members. I was president in 2001 and 2002, and just enjoying myself my old age.
David Narkiewicz, you had a comment?
No.
Oh, you were raising your hand.
No. David, you want to announce your post-mayor plans right now, here today?
No. A career in radio. radio show.
I'd point out the mayor is exercising his right to remain silent at a weird time. Yeah.
By the way, audience members can pose questions or comments. You can step right up to the mic here, or you can compose a note and pass it to our engineers, Josh Smith and Matt Peterson. Listeners, by the way.
Just tweet us.
Just tweet us. Yes, you can tweet us. Are you a
can
tweeter,
you
mayor?
Actually, are you a tweeter?
Am I a tweeter?
Yeah.
I got trouble with that term.
I thought you might
be a little bit more sophisticated to get me interested.
You don't look like a tweeter.
No. Anyway, you can call our...
We're going to beat this into the ground. I can see that.
Our producer, Steph Slish, back in the studio. Listeners can call 586-7140. She will relay the comments to us. A podcast, by the way, will be available a little bit later at WHMP.com. If you're driving to work right now and you're listening to this and now you've got to go into work, you can put it on the computer at work, WHMP.com. Also, this is a great
but
place
not
to
the show. People who work for me.
does the dog still come to work with you?
No.
The dog?
No.
Is the dog still with us?
Yes, the dog is still with us. The dog's home listening to this on the radio right now.
Oh, you're going to get a critique when you get back. Oh, maybe. By the way, the Senior Center is a great place to do your Christmas shopping, too. They've always got sales out here and half-price stuff, so it's pretty good. Let's bring in Stan Moulton from the Gazette right now.
Yeah, I'm interested. Clare, you've had a very interesting career, and I'm wondering, because you went back to your roots, for people who don't know, before you were mayor, you worked for the old HCAC, and you worked for Sojourn for a number of years. How did the 12 years as mayor inform you and help you as you went back into social services?
That's an interesting question. I think the informing went both ways. I used to joke, but not totally joke, that what the best preparation for being mayor was to be the director of a daycare center. And, and I don't mean it. There is some truth to that. But coming back in, I think that being mayor, I came from an organization's early childhood and human services that really deal with scarcity all the time. And while city government, certainly during my period, we took huge cuts in state aid. During the time I was mayor, we still were not as bare bones as any of the organizations that I ever worked with. So coming back, I think more broadly now. I think more about possibility and less about trying to scrape by, because there's a way that you can really make change in a municipal level, even with not as much money as you might need.
Harry Chapman, can we ask you the same question? Being mayor help you with skill sets that came to be useful in your later career?
I believe so. You know, I was very young. I was 32 when I was elected, and I was 34 when I was dismissed. And so,
thanks, Musante.
But obviously the voters believe that the city should go in a different direction, and Dave had a great career here as mayor and for a large number of years. But I think as a young person, just sitting in that chair, at that time it was still a part-time position, although you really were expected to be there full-time. And I visited with Dave with my family over in May, and obviously the compensation that's associated with the position has increased tremendously, and probably still is underpaid in terms of what the responsibilities are. But it's a great preparation for life. And with that, I left and started on a different path. You know, it's interesting.
Could you stop there for one sec? Because
sure.
I think most listeners, many listeners, say, really? Being mayor was a part-time job? When did that stop, and how long did that go on for?
Well, I think Sean actually was the one who spent the majority of his time. And there was a transition, I think, in terms of where the city was and the direction the city was going. And there was a realization that you really just needed to be there a lot. So I got there. Of course, in those days, David, I notice it's not there now. There was a parking place right in front of City Hall on the side street there. So it was a short walk, run up the stairs, and you're in your office. But yeah, it was interesting. And when you leave, I learned the meaning of Garth Brooks did a song about thank God for unanswered prayers, and I wanted to stay. It wasn't the case, but God sometimes has a different plan for you, and so a different direction . And so life grew, and in terms of starting companies and running them and managing them, and I think being associated with the city was interesting in those days. John Graves was a superintendent of schools, and we had a school committee, and of course there were some differences between the school committee and the city. The mayor had the opportunity to chair the school committee and also chair the city council, and so it was really quite intense, but it is great. Was a great preparation in life for me, and I look back on it fondly. And I don't think I would have enjoyed the success that I was ultimately able to achieve if I had not served in that capacity for the term that I was allowed to privilege to be here.
Let's bring in Dave Musante and Mary Ford. Dave, the preparation for a later life given to you by being mayor of Northampton.
I think the preparation for becoming mayor was paramount in my experience. 6 years on the city council and listening to budgets, and then 9 years as a county commissioner, and I was the budget guy. And this helped prepare me for 12 years as mayor of the city. Afterwards, into Russia, and I worked with the mayor of Nizhny Novgorod, the third largest city, with the reforms in that country, and I wrote Russia's first city charter, and certainly my experience as mayor helped in that regard. And introduced in Kyrgyzstan, introduced municipal accounting methods to the city of Karakol in Kyrgyzstan, and got some things started there. So I'd like to say the mayor's job is the best job I ever had. It's the most fulfilling experience of my life. And it was not part-time. It was about 90 hours a week when I was there, and I suppose it still is, David. Maybe 70, because you're younger and faster than I was. But it's been a lot of fun.
Okay, so while we are on that topic, David Narkiewicz, how many hours a week is the mayor's job? Seriously.
I don't actually keep track, but it's definitely a full-time plus job.
You have to punch in when you get in the morning.
No, I don't, but there's a lot of responsibilities. Still chairing the boards, well, not chairing the city council, but chairing the school committee, Smith Vocational Board of Trustees, meetings, lots of responsibilities. But I agree with Mayor Musante. It's the greatest job in the greatest city.
David. Mayor Higgins talked about Twitter earlier. You've embraced social media. You're on Facebook. You've got a presence on Twitter and all that. Is this essential in 2015?
I think it is. I'm sure if you speak with all of the mayors here, one of the struggles of being in this position is trying to get your message out, the things that you're trying to work on, try to talk about, communicate with the public, because that's such a key component of being a successful leader. And what social media allows mayors to do and other public officials to do is to really communicate real time, talk about, what you're doing on a moment-to-moment basis. And I've gotten a lot of great feedback on that. People appreciate that. I think people feel like they have a better understanding about what's going on the day-to-day workings of the city because I'm so out there on social media. So it's a great tool. It also means that people can contact you 24 hours a day with questions about, stop signs and tree limbs and things like that. But again, it's been a great tool.
I know that when Mayor Musante occupied the office, that you, David, spent a lot of time walking the streets, literally. I know for exercise, but also as a way that you really kept in contact, perhaps a different world pre-social media, but that was important to you to stay in contact that way, yes?
A lot of people would be intimidated to climb the steps, and some of them weren't able to the mayor's office. And so I walked every morning for about an hour before I went in, and people would park their cars and come and talk to me, or they'd meet me on the street. I thought it was a good way to campaign. I got some exercise because you're sitting most of the day or running most of the day.
I want to interrupt you because I moved here from Boston in 1981, and I drove a parts truck for the KLA Motors. Mm-hmm. And so I'm driving up and down streets I wasn't too familiar with. And every day I see this guy, and he's walking up and down the street with a furious stride, and he's waving and smiling, and he's got a full-piece suit on and everything else. I thought it was maybe somebody that was on a day pass from the state hospital.
I was going
And Flaherty is your friend, David. I want you to be clear about that.
So I went back to work and I said, "Who the hell is this guy?" That's Mayor Musante. Mm-hmm. So how did the Musante Mile is now memorialized with a plaque on Sheldon Field? Mm-hmm. So how did this all develop, the Musante Mile?
I guess people recognize me as being a walker. It was great. You get out in the morning, get the head fresh. You might have been out and had a few beers the night before, and you get out there and get cleared up.
Now you tell us.
Now that I don't have to run anymore.
I'd be interested. Let me ask Mary Ford the same question. You had a pre-social media mayor's time in the mayor's office. How did you stay involved and in contact with the regular and unsung heroes who were the citizens and voters of Northampton?
Bill, all of us in this field have to figure out a way to stay in touch with people outside of City Hall. I got my exercise having several dogs in the house. So I didn't walk as much as Dave. And I found it very hard to get out of City Hall because of the nature of all the stuff kind of pulling at you. There's always a department or several departments that have something going on where they need your help instantly, never mind the things the public brings in. So I tended to use stuff that was organized by various people as or groups in town as my way of reaching out. So I love going to ball games. I went to the Legion ball games in the summer. I went to the arts openings.
I had to throw the first pitch at Little League a couple of times.
Absolutely.
And you zeroed it right in there. It was amazing.
I don't think so. but that was a way both to touch base with people that otherwise I wouldn't have run into. You come to the Council on Aging, you come to the veterans organizations and so on. And so it was both recreation and outreach.
Marion Labarge is here. Am I doing this right? Yeah, a little bit more forceful? We're back here at the Senior Center in Northampton on Conn Street. Come down and see us. There's going to be reception after our mayoral forum with Harry Chapman, Dave Musante, Clare Higgins, Mary Ford, all former mayors of Northampton, and the current mayor, David Narkiewicz. Bill Newman and myself are hosting this thing along with Stan Moulton from the Daily Hampshire Gazette, the night managing editor, and Stan is going to kick off this segment. Go ahead, Stan.
Current Mayor David Narkiewicz, one of the things that has been in the news recently that you've been working hard on is the payment in lieu of taxes program that you are introducing in Northampton. Why is it important now? What are the difficulties that you're facing in doing that? And while you're speaking, we'd like the former mayors to think about whether they had considered such a program when they were mayor.
Well, one of the challenges that I've faced, and I know my colleagues here faced during my time as mayor, has been, you know, trying to have the necessary revenue to be able to provide the city services that people want. And so one of the issues about Northampton that's kind of unique about Northampton is that in the state, if you look at cities across the state, we are number five in terms of the amount of nonprofit owned property on our tax roll, so exempt properties. We're number five. That's Cambridge, Worcester, Quincy in Boston, and then Northampton. So
number five in terms of percentages value, or of actual value of property?
Value of property.
So
yes.
those four large cities,
yes.
And then Northampton?
I'm wrong about Quincy, though. It's the no, it's where the soldiers, where's the other soldiers' home, Steve?
Chelsea.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's staff here.
So it's Cambridge, Worcester, Chelsea, Boston, Northampton.
In terms of absolute amount of property that is exempt from taxes?
In terms of the percentage of our property value that's owned by tax-exempt institutions. It's on the order of about 23%. So this year I decided, you know, we've talked about pilot for many years. It's been a conversation for many years. So we launched a formal program in October. I presented it formally to the city council to ask our city's largest private nonprofit or tax-exempt property owners to make a contribution in lieu of taxes to help us support city services, including the city services that they consume. So we're in the middle of that. We had a very good debate. We had a lot of town hall meetings about it. And my plan in the new year is to begin making those voluntary requests to our largest. In this case, it's our 10 largest tax-exempt institutions that would be requested to make, over 5 years phased in, working up to 15% of what they would pay. Actually 25% of what they would pay if they were paying taxes, but starting out 5% in the first year and then gradually ramping up to 25%.
Let's ask the other mayors. Clare Higgins, was this an issue when you were mayor?
Sure.
And how did you go about approaching it?
I want to just compliment Mayor Narkiewicz for the approach that he took, and he also took it at the right time. I looked at it in the mid 2000s when we were in the midst of really hard times, but it wasn't only us that was in the midst of hard times. Smith College also was in the midst of hard times. So we actually looked at it, we took a different approach. I didn't think we were going to be able to get money out of them in terms of a straight up pilot. So what we did was work with them as they negotiated their expansion into neighborhoods around the college, and looked at doing a sort of no net loss approach to the city, that they would pay a payment in lieu of taxes for anything that they took off the tax rolls. They would continue to pay for those properties. So if they put stuff back on the tax rolls, then they could net that out. But trying to keep their share of the tax exemption constant, if that makes sense to folks. And I kind of got roundly criticized by all sides on this, but I think actually it worked in terms of them continuing to provide to the community. They also were required to replace any housing that they took off the market with housing that was affordable to the community at 80% of median income, and that guarantee was for 99 years. So I think we did pretty well in that negotiation in terms of keeping Smith College themselves committed to supporting the city. I didn't go broader than that, partly again because we were in the middle of a Great Recession, and a lot of the other folks that might have given us money were also in the middle of that too. We had an opportunity with Smith because they wanted to expand, and we took it.
Let's turn to the other mayors as well. Harry Chapman, you look at Smith College as CEO, you as the CEO of Northampton, it may have been a $500 million endowment then, it's a $2 billion endowment now, and you'll say, you know, that institution could afford to make more of a contribution to the city. Was that something that was on your agenda, or was too early for that?
Yeah, it really was too early. When I came into office in 77, our main street was sort of falling apart. A number of stores were closed. The industrial park was really pretty empty. And so our challenges were, how could we build the tax base from that? And so that's when Coca-Cola, Al Griggs and Norm Tiedemann and I flew down to Hamburg, Pennsylvania, to try to cement that deal, which ultimately I've been through the industrial park. It certainly is a very large complex. Mm-hmm. With Main Street, we started a new sign program to get them more attractive, more consistent with the community. We put new sidewalks in with bricks and benches and so forth. So those were the issues that we focused on, the CBD, to build the tax base in the industrial park. So those are the challenges that we face. This is before this time. But to David's point, Massachusetts is a difficult state, because it's sort of stagnant in terms of population growth. It's kind of stagnant in terms of new industries locating here because of the tax base that the state has in place. Texas, much different, very entrepreneurial, fast-growing communities, lots of folks moving in. So there's really not a challenge for that. But to David's challenge with trying to raise revenue to cover costs and operations, people don't want to see their tax rate increased if they don't have to. And so where does he look to for a source of money? I'm not going to comment as to whether this is the right or wrong program. I think that's a difficult challenge for a mayor, and I empathize for David's challenges, but I think I'll pass on that in terms of the impact on the community today.
Mary Ford?
Yeah, I thought a lot about pilot payment in lieu of taxes, and we had staff people look at it, did a little bit of research about other communities, and I decided that since you have to choose your battles, I wasn't going to go into full-out efforts on that. We did have some counselors who thought it was past time for it to happen. So I also did individual negotiations, worked with Smith on a number of issues. Probably the best was parking, trying to get resolution to the perennial Ward 2 and versus Smith College parking needs, and went to Cooley Dickinson, and they started and have continued to use their professional staff to help with our athletes and their physical training, and hopefully having somebody attend the games so there's somebody medical around in case of emergency. A failure would be with the feds. They decided, rather than contributing more, they shut down their fire department so that our fire department had to expand their services. Nothing we could do about it because
Meaning at the VA hospital.
Yeah. Thanks, Dan.
Let's turn to Mayor David Musante.
My first term, we had to implement Prop 2.5. Everybody knows what a tough time that was, getting budgets down in order to comply. We didn't lay anybody off during 2.5 because we got at it earlier. I brought the police chief and the fire chief and the director of the public works in. I said, what is the lowest complement of people that you can get along with without putting the city in jeopardy? They gave me numbers, and I took the flack, and we got down to those numbers, and we didn't have to lay anyone off. The town-gown relationship with with Smith College is the best that I've seen, and observed in Houston with Rice University, the relationship there, and at Cal State Fullerton with the city of Fullerton, the relationship there. And I think Smith College is a gem in this community. If you look at it from an employment perspective, high wages, steady employment for people, and it just gives Northampton that much more class. So and I congratulate David on doing one great job. I think with an endowment that Smith has, they certainly could afford a 25%. Not that everyone's not out for, you know, to do the best they can for the people they serve, and Smith is trying to do the best that they can for their students and future students. But I think the relationship, in the old days, we hadn't thought of that, but Smith occasionally would buy a fire truck or they'd do other things to help the city. So I think the spirit is there, and there's other cities that I understand that David, Boston, and others are doing the same thing, and I think with numbers, there's strength, and if some of these other cities get it, it's going to encourage others to go on and do the same. So I think you're to be applauded. I think.
Thank you.
Dave Musante just mentioned 25%. David Narkiewicz, could you explain that for those of our listeners who might not?
It's basically the proportion of the city budget that's devoted to core services, public works, police, fire. It's those core services, and that's Mayor Musante mentioned Boston. Boston, under Mayor Menino, started a program that I've basically modeled Northampton's program after, and they use that same metrics of 25%. So, and again, that's where we're really asking for.
And that would mean that they would pay 25% of the amount that they would pay if the land was on the tax rolls.
Exactly. That's the theory. But we're doing it over 5 years, phasing it in over 5 years, so in the first year we would only ask for 5%. And then it would go up in 5% increments until we reach 25%, so that they'd have the ability to adjust their budget.
Clare Higgins?
I think it's really important, and Mayor Musante mentioned this, that Prop 2.5 capped the basic funding source for municipalities. It said that the property tax, which is really the way municipalities pay their bills, is now capped. Now, that's not to say that was it a terrible thing. It forced discipline into the budgeting process. Property taxes are inherently unfair because they're not tied to people's income. But it did mean that cities had to be looking for other ways to pay the bills. And so the tax exemption that—
Our producer is telling me to get closer to the mic.
The tax exemption that Smith College and the other nonprofits, including, quite frankly, my agency, enjoy, is not given by the city. It's given by state and federal government, but it's not reimbursed by the state and federal government. So there's a bigger conversation to have here. We have a 17th century tax system, the property tax, trying to deal with 21st century problems. And there needs to be a bigger conversation about this. And maybe it'll happen if more municipalities are pushing the nonprofits to be part of the conversation.
Mayor Ford, if I could bring, maybe get a little bit personal for a second here. The late Raymond Ish LaBarge, city councilor, Ward 7. Safe to say that he was a thorn in your side, someone that you locked horns with regularly. But at his funeral, you told me that your slugfests were very valued and led to significant outcomes. Can you talk about political nemesis like Ish? And I'd like to have other mayors maybe talk about their political thorns in their side. Go ahead, Mayor.
Sure. Well, it's really just common sense. When there's conversation out in the community that one of your elected colleagues is hearing, you need to know what that is. And so even if you take a different position, I'm a firm supporter in public debate about those things. So I liked having Ish on the council, somebody like Jack Fitzgerald, very much more conservative than me on a lot of issues, because it meant that people knew that they were being represented. They were not being screened out by City Hall. So, yeah, and you know, it keeps you honest. If you're letting down in any way, there need to be people looking over your shoulder. That's the nature of at least local politics.
Did it feel that way at the time?
No.
What about the legendary Jim Brooks? Can somebody comment on Jim? Mayor Musante.
I'd like to comment on Ray LaBarge, Ish LaBarge. If I had any success as mayor in the early years, a good deal of the credit goes to Ray LaBarge. Ray and I saw eye to eye, and I explained the programs that I wanted to get across. And Ray was retired, had all kinds of time. He'd work on the conservatives, Len Budger and Jack Fitzgerald and some of the others, and he'd spend hours trying to convince them to do something. You know, if you're active, you're an active mayor, you don't have time for really doing what you should be doing in that regard, and Ray was fantastic there. He was sort of like the mercury on your weather forecast sometimes. He's up and down, but overall, I think he was a real asset to the city. Jim Brooks, my idol. He was a Ward 6 counselor. Jim used to come in, and he had more wild ideas when he was on the council. And he'd come in, and he'd pitch something, and I'd try to debate with him until I finally smartened up, and I started nodding with him. And he came in a couple of meetings later, and he said, Mayor Musante, he said, you keep nodding, which I leads me to believe that you're going to get something done. I says, yes, I nodded my head. With Jim, was a different sort, but he really represented the people in Ward 6. One of the things, he slowed traffic on Moran Road that no one was able to do. And Billy Lynch is here. He remembers patrolling up in that area, and the citizens were crazy. Jim got out there with a hairdryer that looked like a radar gun, and he had the traffic slowing down. They thought that the police department had armed him with a radar gun. So he had his real pluses, I think.
We have, by the way, you can call, listeners can call our producer, Steph Slish, back at the studio, 586-7140, and she will relay any comments that listeners have as you're going to work. And we do have one, we had a Twitter comment, this is directed to Mayor Narkiewicz, and I think other mayors can chime in, but this is from Twitter. What is the biggest challenge that you face as mayor, and how do you deal with all these diverse constituents?
You know, the biggest challenge probably gets back to the whole issue of the budget, and how do you provide the level of services that people want? How do you keep our schools strong? How do you do all that in the budgetary framework that, you know, Mayor Higgins described? So that's probably it. And in terms of the diverse constituency, I think that's one of the strengths of Northampton, that we do have so many different voices and so many different people that are actively engaged in the city. I'd be concerned if I wasn't hearing from people in the community about issues. Positive or negative. I think that's one of the strengths of Northampton, that we have such an engaged populace.
By the way, this is not a very formal discussion here. So mayors, if you do have a comment, if you want to expand upon something that another mayor said, you can just, you know, raise your hand or something, or just jump in. Harry Chapman.
I want to go back to the original question in terms of Nemesis, I guess, and also Ish was a big supporter, and he's a great guy. And Jim Brooks, Joe Bono, was the city councilor from Ward 6 when I ran, and Ward 6 at that time encompassed all of what is really Florence, went all the way out to the other side of Bridge Street, and so I mean it was a huge, and I walked that whole both boards, both precincts and the ward, and so what I had, I printed this 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. I said, this is my total campaign budget, and I walk the ward, knock on the door, and leave a sheet of paper. But I did get to Jim's house, and it was a long visit, because he was big, because he didn't like Calderwood,
next door in the landfill. That was his big nemesis, and we got to learn. I got to learn about aquifers and water. So now I win, and Jim would show up. I would venture to say at least one or two Saturdays a month at my front door. Come on in, Jim, and we spend a good 2 hours. And so I had an opportunity to come back for a city council meeting. Dave was mayor, and okay, Jim was on the city council. I said, right. Gosh, you know how things have changed. And but going on to Nemesis, probably keep in mind when I was mayor, we had a lot of 5-4 votes. We had Mario Mazza, Marion Mendelson, Len Butger, Harold Craig was there. Charlie Baranowski was the Ward 6. Paul Bixby, Jack Fitzgerald, Fran McNulty. I think I've got them all. Mm-hmm. And so there are a lot of 5-4 votes. And when you go through that, Charlie Baranowski, who by the way was an interesting friend, but virtually we differed in how perhaps government should be run. And so that ultimately ended up in terms.
Yeah, seems like we might have to share mics here at some point. But Mayor Musante, you had a comment? Yeah.
Interesting, Dave's comments on constituent service is very, very important, especially if you want to go on politically. And but it has its lighter moments as well. And I don't want to offend anyone with Donald Trump and the Muslims and all of this business. But my secretary, Marianne Donahue, got a call from a lady down in the Meadows area of the city. And she was having all kinds of problems. She said, Westover Field is overrun with Puerto Ricans. Now, you know, you don't say that sort of thing. And Marianne's on the phone. This lady's got a little bit of a problem. And she says they've tuned the radar into her house, and dishes are falling off the shelves, and the doorbell's ringing in the middle of the night, and there's nobody there, and the lights are flashing off and on. And Marianne comes into my office. She says, I can't take any more of this. You take this call. So I got the call, and she's on the other end. And so I listened to the lady. I said, you know, you're not the first call I've had. I've had several others, and I got a hold of the FBI yesterday, and they're sending a whole team of agents out to Westover, and they're going to clean up the mess out there. And she thanked me, and I'm sure I got her vote the rest of the rest of the terms. And Marianne came in afterwards, and she says, you know, Mayor, she says, I think you're crazier than she is. You're probably right.
We're going to take a break in about 4 or 5 minutes. Let's go to Stan Moulton.
Dave Musante, you mentioned Proposition 2.5, and of course, that led to overrides of Proposition 2.5. I wanted to start this by asking Mary Ford what she learned from the first failed override in her term as mayor in 92. Because that was a general override. You then had some successful overrides for mm-hmm. specific projects like the fire station and JFK and so forth. Right. What were the lessons learned from that? And also, when do you, as mayor or mayor, former mayors, ask for an override?
Good question. And Mayor Narkiewicz also has been very successful with this, managed to get an override for more than 1 year in a row of the operating budget. But that's what I felt we needed when I came into office after Dave had struggled with 2.5. And as a counselor, I had watched this. I got some advisory people, very smart finance people who also knew the community. They quickly did an overview, interviewing every department. They came back to me and said, there's really no room to save anymore in the city budget beyond what you've already done. And I did continue squeezing department budgets just like Dave had done. So I put that override out, and I didn't have Dave's creativity to wave a large size bottle of soda around in front of the TV cameras. When he was able to get an override, for whatever reason that failed, and I think part of it was simply that I was too new. People were not able to trust that I knew what I was doing. But I also realized that as much as maybe 75% of your time in office, when you're in City Hall, you're struggling with those tight budgets. And I cut positions, not necessarily cutting staff, but cut positions 3 out of my 8 years. People can't see that. And it's a national trend. People want better services with fewer tax dollars. We want our roads and bridges fixed nationally, but people hesitate to raise taxes. So my lesson was, the next overrides have to be for things that can be seen. And that's why I went for capital. They're technically not the same kind of override, but a debt exclusion to modernize the junior high school, then build a totally new firehouse, then modernize the high school. And in each case, we put together committees that represented all segments of the community to help sell the override. So it wasn't just the mayor's override.
Which in the case of the high school became an entire community endeavor, and I think passed by 75 or 80%. It was really an quite extraordinary political and community event. We are back. This is the Northampton Mayor's Forum. We are broadcasting live at the Northampton Senior Center. I'm Bill Newman, along with my colleague Bob Flaherty, and Stan Moulton, Daily Hampshire Gazette longtime editor, who are posing questions to Mayors David Narkiewicz, Clare Higgins, Mary Ford, Dave Musante, and Harry Chapman. This is co-produced. This program is co-produced with NCTV, and we appreciate the Senior Center's hospitality in hosting us this morning. We were talking earlier in the show about 5-4 votes at the City Council, something that actually does not happen that frequently at the moment. We were also talking about some of the contentious issues that came up and had to be addressed by the mayors, these mayors, during their terms. Northampton has not always been this progressive mecca. And I recall the bitterness over the domestic partnership ordinance that was defeated in Northampton in a vote. I recall the 5-4 votes at the City Council, and it has not all been one long kumbaya moment. I'm sorry, did I tell secrets out of school? I didn't mean to.
No, you said kumbaya.
Thank you for pointing that out, Claire. I'd like to know from the mayors what was perhaps the most difficult issue that they individually had to deal with while they were mayor, and what the resolutions were. And I would appreciate it if, in answering that question, you could talk some about what was a very divisive kind of verbalization of this divide in Northampton, this so-called NoHo versus Hamp, which we fortunately, thank goodness, no longer hear very much about. But it was very real for a long time. So let's start with Clare Higgins, and then we'll go to our other panelists.
So that's interesting that you frame it in the NoHo Hamp issue. I think we don't hear that so much anymore, but I don't know that that doesn't exist still. I think we just don't hear about it so much. And the domestic partnership ordinance piece, which you bring up, is symbolic of that. In a way, was the last gasp, I think. It came up at a time when, just a few years later, the Supreme Court in Massachusetts legalized gay marriage. So I actually think if that hadn't failed, if other attempts to sort of find civil unions hadn't failed, we might not have ended up with gay marriage in the same way. So I actually think it's fine that it played out the way it did. I will say that on the same ballot as the domestic partnership ordinance, which failed, I think, by 79 votes, I was one of the top vote getters in the city as an out person running for office. Michael Bardsley was one of the, won his race as an out person running for office. I think the message of that election was, institutionally, we're not going to recognize gay and lesbian people, but they're okay. Right? Sort of level of acceptance, but without recognition. And that's kind of the path of gay and lesbian people moving towards full rights in our system. We're still moving that way, right? Massachusetts is way far ahead. And that was contentious, but I think there were some other things that were contentious that had nothing to do with sort of the NoHo Hamp thing. I think all of the budget cuts that I had to make during the period of time that I was there was contentious because we weren't able to increase school budgets. We had to cut health insurance or change health insurance benefits for city employees, very contentious labor negotiations. All of those things were very, very difficult. And went to the ballot twice to get a general override, was able to get one. Out of the two times we were able to actually get one, partly because a number of citizens rose up and said, hey, we're gonna make this happen. It can't just be the elected officials that say we want this to happen. It has to be the community, similar to the high school. You know, the people have to come together and say, we want our community to be okay, and that group, the Yes Northampton group, is still together working to try to make things better in Northampton. So I think, when I think about the divisive issue, you know, the landfill as a hugely divisive issue. It wasn't a Hamp know-how issue. It might have been a urban-rural issue in the city. But I don't think it was a Hamp know-how issue per se. And I think more and more in the city, people who've been here, born and raised here, second, third generation, really appreciate the changes that have happened in Northampton and have a lot of pride in the city, just like the people who move here. I don't
You're going to turn this into a kumbaya moment, aren't you?
I'm going to say one thing. I do think that there are folks who move here, and I think all of it, you know, you move from somewhere else, you come because you like the place the way it is, and then you want to freeze it in that moment. So there's a lot of, there's just as much resistance from people who moved here now 20 years ago as there's people who went to Hamp High and graduated 50 years ago, because change is the constant in our life, right? Things change all the time, but we all want to freeze it in the moment that we have our memories of. So it's interesting to me the fights I would have with people about that were just brand new here, that didn't want, the development of the state hospital was the sort of prime example of that. People who didn't want us to do anything at the state hospital. I had more pushback on that from people who were new to Northampton than I did from people who were born and raised here. People who were born and raised here are like, please, do something about the state hospital. So, you know, the lines weren't always so clear.
Mary Ford, did you have something to follow up with that?
I think Claire's analysis I would agree with. In general, I think we have a population in the city, old and new, that wants their local government to succeed. It's not a population that wants to see, a lot of public discord or name calling or anything like that. And so that's a really good base. It's a good ground for people to stand on when they're in a public office. There were times where we had a lot of tension around something really kind of small. We had a big public hearing, Dave might have still been the mayor then, about Pulaski Park's fencing. And you know, the room was full and there were people lining the sides of the small auditorium or the council chambers when we had that discussion. Because one group had been maintaining the little fences in a certain way. Public Works folks technically were in charge of the park, and they had a different viewpoint. And boy, were people upset about that. Now, that means nothing today, okay? It's not even a footnote in history. But it is an example of where some real specific thing comes to the attention of a group, and the group wants to become vocal. Again, I think that's good. And I sort of feel like we need to make sure today we still have some curmudgeons, which is, you know, how I thought of Jim Brooks, from whatever point of view. And I'm willing to serve as a curmudgeon from the left anytime people think it's needed. You need tensions to kind of bring out your best. At the same time, as mayor, you're trying to keep a larger vision of where you'd like the whole community to go, as well as government per se, and you're doing the budget struggles. But a lot of those little things, boy, we had a meeting, staff people from city were in tears when there was a meeting about could a homeless shelter, which would be a couple of temporary rooms, be set up on some land that the Public Works Department was in charge of, behind our Public Works Department. And people came out to talk about that, and you would have thought that, I don't know, the devil himself were about to take over the city with that particular proposal. Mm. Well, I don't know that the whole city was against it, but the neighbors were, and it felt at that time that a perfectly reasonable proposal, because we didn't know how to solve this problem, perfectly reasonable thing that we had floated, why it would get such strong reaction. But it did, and in the end, we're still a community that tries to provide services for the homeless one way or another.
Thanks, Mayor Ford. By the way, we've got this mic right here. Anybody wants to step up to the mic? Oh, we have a gentleman right here.
Yes.
Go ahead.
I'm Jim Sullivan, Northampton. I was in walking the city the other day, and the police chief looked at me, and she smiled, and I said, oh, my God, I'm in trouble. You know,
I think it's the Yankee hat. I think.
Yeah, yeah, I wasn't in trouble. I just wanted to just say thank you, Mayor Narkiewicz. By the way, I'm not a stringer. You know, I don't know the mayor personally, but for appointing this wonderful person as police chief, the idea of being present in a city, the idea of even an encounter with a police chief where the person is smiling and it's not kumbaya. I know we have issues here. I know things have to be addressed. I know we have to keep a safe city, etc. But it's just nice to have the police commissioner who is part of us and the presence of the police in our city. Thank you.
Well, thank you for that comment.
Mayor Higgins, by the way, let me know when the 3-minute mark is up so I can do one of these.
I'd like to broaden the question, if I might, and ask the mayors to comment on what was the biggest public safety issue while you were in office, and how did you resolve it? Maybe we could just ask each one of the mayors that. Let's start with Dave Musante. Yeah.
Well, there's a couple that come to mind that were very contentious, and you have to realize that Northampton was not always, hadn't always been as progressive as it is today. Back in the early 80s, it was anything but. The first lesbian and gay march was held here in Northampton. I was mayor, and they'd come in, they petitioned to march on a Saturday. From a public safety perspective, Danny Labata, who was chief, said, Saturday's a bad day. It's a business day. There's liable to be trouble. You know, there's folks on both sides of this issue. And the merchants are all open, and the downtown is very busy. Much better to have it the next day on a Sunday.
Right, and the police chief turned down the parade permit request.
Well, we did it together, because the chief didn't do much without consulting with me on matters like that.
I said you?
Yeah, yeah.
The ACLU did, actually, technically.
Yeah, well, so we turned it down anyway, and they took us to court, and they marched on a...
They being Bill Newman.
Pardon?
They, Bill Newman, took you to court.
Was it Bill?
It was an ACLU colleague, it is true.
But anyway, the city lost, and the march was held on a Saturday, and it rained cats and dogs. I mean, it poured. And then the Sunday, when we wanted to have it, the sun was out, and it was beautiful. But that's neither here nor there. You lose some, and you win some. But the rain didn't.
Right, and I would point out that in that march, a lot of people wore brown paper bags over their heads, because they did not want to be recognized for fear of losing their jobs, for fear of being ostracized in their community. And that was not ancient history.
Let me ask
another one other controversial thing. Housing was affordable housing was a real problem in the city of Northampton in the early 80s. And we had a huge demonstration. The state hospital had closed. You had all those doctors' buildings up there, the doctors lived in, and other buildings that were vacant, just sitting there. And the people didn't understand. They were marching. The Pulaski Park was filled with people. I got a hold of Mike Dukakis on the phone. I told him the problem. We've got all these vacant buildings in the state hospital that aren't being used, and we got all these people living in the parks and in the meadows and different places, and they don't understand this, and I don't either. And if you don't do something about making some of that available, I'm going to start marching with them. He says, "Well, don't do that." So he got a hold of his communities and communities and secretary anyway. And I got a call within an hour, and we got the building. Pat, what's the name of that? No, the other one on the big apartment type place. Yeah, Bob and Hill. We got that, and we all went in and fixed it up and made it available for tenants. So that, you know, those things happen. And the gay and lesbian movement early on was very, very militant. I mean militant. Today, I appointed Mary Higgins, got her started on the Housing Authority, and from there we appointed her to the Planning Commission, and she served mayor, I think,
almost as long as you, four
days less than me or something. Yeah.
But who's
at least they're not competitive.
Who's counting?
That's the important
who's counting?
Thing.
I did receive a check.
But, you know, Clare Higgins, Bill Dwight often talks about this is a tolerant community, it's a tolerant state, and it really rankles him that we tolerate you. Does that bother you at all?
You're only tolerating me, Bob?
That's how Bill Dwight puts it. That seems to be the wrong word to be used in this day and age.
I want to go back to something else, but I'll talk about that for a minute. I think it all starts with tolerance, right? I mean, let's start there. If you're not tolerating people, you're not going to get to acceptance. And then you're not going to get to celebration. And I think if you look at the history of what's happened with gay and lesbian people in this city and in this state and more increasingly in this country, we're making that journey. And so, you know, I got elected city council and mayor. Nobody really made too big a deal over how I identified. And there's really no gay or lesbian way to approach the parking situation, although I think I did threaten to put in lavender meters. there's not a gay and lesbian approach to the business of governing. And so I think we have moved in that way. And you know, certainly nobody wants to settle for tolerance, but you might need to start there. Mm. And you know, I'll say militancy is really in the eye of the beholder. Right? So when you're in a position of power and people are mad at you, and sometimes for good reason and sometimes for not, you think, wow, geez, they're being kind of... And people were mad at me about some stuff, and I constantly had to remind myself that I had to step back and try to see things from their point of view. Like, I had a lot of power to make decisions that some people didn't like, and so I had to try to take that point of view. I may end up not agreeing with them, or I may have to set a limit, but it's still, I had to take that point of view and try to think about it. Anyway, I want to go back to the public safety issues, because I think there's a thread in a way. Mayor Musante talked about the homeless issue. It's one that's still with us and presents public safety concerns, and less about danger to people in the city, but danger to the homeless people
yes.
themselves who are living in conditions that they shouldn't be living in.
Yes.
And you know, every single one of us had the experience of somebody dying who didn't have a house to live in somewhere in the city, and more than one. And that, you know, has been a passion, I think, for a thread that you'll see through, I know through Dave to Mary, to me, and to David Narkiewicz in terms of thinking about housing for people in the city, because it's something that's so desperately needed for a healthy community. So that is a really important piece. And then clearly the strongest memory I have of a public safety challenge when I was mayor was the arson fires that we had, on, which, you know, was devastating. So,
yeah.
But it showed really a work that had begun so many years ago in terms of bringing the police and the fire department and all of our emergency services together to serve the city. And it's just a tribute, the work that they did together, number one, to fight those fires, to assure the city that they were safe, and then to solve the crime was an incredible tribute to their work.
Absolutely. Mayor Chapman.
Yeah, I wanted to come back. There's a lot of topics, but this is a couple of things I wanted to cover. When I talked about the 5-4 votes, but one of the things that I think the community understands it, even though there are those kinds of debates within the city council, generally when the meeting's over, you get together, you may go out and have a cup of coffee or a beer, whatever it was after the meeting. So even though there can be some very strong debates, doesn't necessarily mean they're not personal, they're professional, a business perspective. And to go on, I was mayor, I came on the city council in 1971, so I was 26.
I think we've got
and it's a different time. It's interesting for me to listen to all the challenges that occurred afterward and what's taking place in this community. But it was a much different time. There were issues where there were 5-4 votes, nothing to the extent of what I think we talk about here today in terms of later on with this community. But there were a lot of small issues that caused some differing of opinions. But I think as a whole, it was a different time. The last thing is that in terms of public safety, it's a long time ago, but we had a significant issue in the police department at that time, and Jim Whalen, retired, has police chief, and there were police officers that were under indictment. It was a significant challenge. I asked Bill Hurley, Buffer Hurley, to serve as the chair of that commission, and we went through every list of offense, and all of those were upheld. Interestingly enough, when I was back in town here visiting with David, Russ Sinkowitz was the first person I appointed to the police department. And it was interesting to me to see just how far he was a young man and how far he had come. But in terms of issues, we had some changes in the fire department. We had city contracts that hadn't been executed in 3 years. All a lot of small issues, nothing to the extent of what I think the community has experienced with these mayors that are besides me. And it was a different time, but nothing to the extent of what I think has been observed here.
We're going to be talking about the charter in just a couple of minutes with Mayor Narkiewicz, and this gentleman here has a... You talked to me yesterday, didn't you? You called me yesterday.
I talked to you on the telephone. Yes,
that's right. Peter Jones, go ahead.
How do you do? One thing that hasn't been, I guess it's been kind of underlying everything, but nobody has brought it up. When I moved to Northampton, it was run entirely by men. Men had been mayors for all of Northampton's more than 300 years at the time. Men were on the city council. But then one year, a woman from Ward 7, Franny McNulty, was elected to the city council. She was, as far as I know, the first woman to serve on the city council. And now we have a balance of men and women on the city council, and it's not even an issue anymore. When Mary Ford was elected mayor, she was the first woman to be mayor in Northampton. Years later, when Clare Higgins decided to retire from the job, or resign from the job, and Dave Narkiewicz was about to become mayor, a little girl asked her father, "I've heard that a man is going to be mayor. Can a man really be mayor in Northampton?"
That's good.
Municipal government, like other things, and at the national and state level too, is starting to become, I hesitate to say it, women's work. I guess it's because women are good at it.
Well, let's pose the question to mayors, Clare Higgins and Mary Ford. Thank you so much for the comment. Is there a comment?
Well, Clare Higgins. Mary was the trailblazer here and you know, stepped in at a time when I think it was not so easy. You know, it got a lot of pushback, and I can say that Mary, Mary may not want to talk about it, but, you know, people were disparaging around. I think it was very difficult for department heads, especially the uniform services, to think that a woman was their boss. And Mary really blazed that trail in a way that I take my hat off to her if I wore a hat, but politicians aren't supposed to wear hats, so I don't have one on.
Right, because the hats are always tossed into the ring where they get lost. Yeah. Got it.
Or there's a picture of you that bubbles up somewhere else later. So, yeah.
Mary Ford was a difficult task to run for mayor as the first woman candidate for mayor?
It did not feel to me that in the political race that my gender was too much of a problem, mostly because I had such a great group of people around me and behind me. And they did represent many segments of the city. They didn't only represent newcomers or left-wingers or whatever. And they were solid people who could tell other people, yeah, I think she knows what she's talking about, or, you know, whatever they needed to hear to be comfortable putting me into the executive office. Yeah, there was there were definitely people in the community and inside city departments who were not ready for it. But once you're in, if you can win a second term, then I think it puts those questions to rest.
Did you feel, Mary, as the first woman mayor in Northampton, an extra responsibility as a role model for other women who were eyeing political office?
If I was supposed to be a role model, I don't know if I was a good one. For instance, they invented Twitter just so that you'd have to keep your comments to 140 characters. So what serves Mayor Narkiewicz well, it would have kept me out of office. I was aware of it, and particularly when you are around younger people, when you do go into the schools, which I think all of us love doing, and most of us here have been what are called education mayors. We supported the public school system. And then they say, oh, she's the first woman. And sure, if you feel a little bit of extra glow. On the other hand, when they call you Queen Mary, it means they're not as happy with you being, you know, somebody
you were much heavier
giving
then.
Orders.
Can I just make a point here, though? But between Mary and I, we handed close to 20 years of diplomas out to kids in high school. That means young women who were graduating from our school system got their diploma from a woman. Yeah. And I think that's a pretty important thing, that 20 years of women, of young women knew that here was another thing that they could aspire to.
Dave Musante?
Yeah, women have come to the fore in a big way politically. I know if I was just starting out, I would seriously think about having a sex change before I'd run for mayor.
Okay, we're entering into that too much information category and rapidly.
If you make that decision, can I do the documentary? Because I know we could sell that.
Can I just add one quick thing
Really, you want to get in on this?
I guess if I'm allowed to. Not about his reality TV show, but it's interesting. So I'm, you know, we joke I broke the glass ceiling after 20 years of Mary and Mary, and but if you look at all of my department heads, look at my financial team, my finance director, my auditor, my treasurer collector, my assessor are all women. I appointed the first female police chief. So I think the complexion has that change has gone down through our departments as well. And so, you know, it's not just the top job, but you know, I'm sure when you came in, Mayor Ford or other mayors, there probably weren't a lot of women department heads at that point. So, mm-hmm. So the change has continued, and I think it's really benefited city government.
Fred Cotrot is here. Gets it up to the mic from Mass Live.
You've all had a defining moment in your tenure. I think Dave's. I wasn't here for it, but I think it was when it was a chance to redevelop downtown, and maybe in a worse way, and you chose the better way. And Claire, you might have a different take on it, but it was maybe Ford Hall and all the hoopla around that. Dave, maybe you haven't had yours yet. But
he's paving paradise and putting up a parking lot.
But Mary's, because I covered her at the time, was, I would say, appointing, making the police department and the fire department progressive by appointing progressive leaders. And I think you spent a lot of political capital on it. Never really got your due. If anything, you took heat for it. I just like you all to talk about those moments a bit.
Mary
yeah,
Ford.
Yeah, so those two appointments are things that I'm very proud of. I don't know how to say this exactly, but it seems to me that in this community, early on I said people will want you to succeed. They by and large, don't want to bring you down. They want a good government that they believe in. When we run for an office like this, I think we want to spend our political capital. There are certainly places where you run for mayor hoping that you'll get good enough press that you can run for the next step up. And it did happen to Calvin Coolidge, and I don't think it's happened to anyone since then. Most of us, whether we move on to something higher or not, we may look for something in government at a different level because it interests us and it has good pay and people knew we did a good job with our position in the city. But we want to leave the city of Northampton and its government better than when we came in, and each of us has tried to build on what the others did. So
thank
not
you.
Much more than that to say.
Thank you for that, Mary
Ford. Chapman.
I would like to just note before this goes by the board, this from Historic Northampton in preparation for this forum today. Historic highlights, Northampton mayors. Northampton was governed, I did not know this, Northampton was governed by a board of selectmen from its founding in 1654 until 1883 when it was incorporated as a city and the first citywide election was held in December of that year, 1883. We had other comments? Harry Chapman.
Yes, I think political capital is probably a pretty important issue. And from the get-go, from my first city council meeting, that's when we appointed Danny Lobato as police chief and Jerry Driscoll as fire chief. It did burn some political capital for me, and you consistently do that. You always have to do what you think is in the best interest of the city, and it's a risk. For me, it only lasted 2 years. But the point is I remember one of the major issues to me, and I was talking with Al Griggs about it just a while ago, is that when it came time to fill the industrial park, Coca-Cola wanted to move into the city, and so we flew down in Al's plane, and we met with them, and they came in, I'm not sure this is a long time ago, but that's when the bottle bill was just coming up for debate, and I remember it as long as I live there were problems with the city's financing in those days. Initially, we put before a department head could spend any money, we said anything over $100 had to come to me for signature, spends political capital. But it was the right thing to do, and in the city's finances, and then over the next couple of years, our tax rate went down. But on the bottle bill, the girls at Smith College were just terribly angry for me, and I can remember that if that bottle bill passed, I was told by Coke that we probably couldn't build the industrial park. Well, we only had $300 million in taxable assets. And so that new development was important for jobs. If you remember, that was a time when unemployment was growing in the state of Massachusetts, growing in Texas. And so I sent a letter off to Ed King and said, please don't veto this bill. I think Ed was going to veto the bill anyway, but it was important for our community. And Al probably remembers this as well. They did some political advertising on their Coke bottles in this election, and I made them take all the Coke off the shelf. So we're not going to do advertising in our stores that we had at that particular time. And ultimately, the governor held it up and said, I got this letter from Buzz Chapman, and I'm going to veto this bill. Well, the point was that you do the things, and I know that, and you all had much longer tenures in office than I did, and I'm sure there are a lot of issues, but you sleep at night well, and you do what you think, and you have a good conscience. And so when it's over, you accept it, and hopefully the community will come out better for that.
Harry Chapman, I think we may just have confused some listeners a bit because you referred to yourself as Buzz Chapman, which is how we refer to you, but it's Harry Chapman on the email signature block. So buzz. Where did it come from, and do you still use it? This is a really crucial question, and you'll have full 30 seconds to answer.
Whenever I get a call at the house, because I have two daughters and a wife, and so I know if the call comes to the house, it's not for me, but it comes from Buzz Chapman. Oh, you're going to call.
It's from Northampton.
I was a square dance caller. That's how I made my living working with through college.
And, do you still have that, by the way, a square dance caller? I've heard rumors to this. Do you still have it? Can you still do it? Can you give us a sample?
Probably not here. But yeah, I do now volunteer work and for schools and things. But I haven't actually worked as a professional square dance caller since 1985. So it's been a long time.
Jeez. I'm all ready to dance. I don't know about you, Claire.
I'm never ready to dance. So.
This I would pay to see.
Yeah, no, it's fine. But there's a thread that runs through some of the things that Fred brought up, and I think on the issue of housing, at least through Dave, Mary, my tenure, and now into David Narkiewicz's tenure, all of us focused on housing in some way. Dave put together the housing partnership. He took on some real big challenges in the housing authority. Mary continued with doing work on homelessness, as Dave did. I did a lot of work at the state hospital, work that started well before me, and David is still working on. There's a thread around housing in this community that there's been a passion and a commitment to trying to create and maintain affordable housing that I think has spanned, now three or four decades that leadership has continued. I think it's been really important to the city, and I'll just mention that, I did a lot of work in housing and started my city political career in housing. The thing that I'm probably most proud of is the preservation of Meadowbrook Apartments, which we were able to hold on to as affordable housing in the city after a multi-year battle that John Haidt was involved in. We had partners in state government involved in it, even during the Romney administration that supported us holding on to that. But it's part of that continual thread about saying we want Northampton to be a welcoming place for all, not just people with the income to live here.
On the question of affordable housing, and this is not strictly affordable housing, but I would like to know, all of you as mayors have dealt with this question of the development on what was known as Hospital Hill and now has another name. Are you satisfied? Are you content with how that development has turned out? Let's just go down the road and ask. Let's start, David Narkiewicz.
Yeah, well, I mean, the original goals, if you go back and look at the original master plan, it was supposed to be a mix of housing types, which we have. It was supposed to be a mix of income levels, and we do have a good mix of affordability. There was even in the legislation that people who were clients of DMH should be residents, and we've achieved that. And then we also obviously have some commercial tax base with what we used to know as Cole Morgan, now L3KEO is now there, our largest taxpaying employer. There's still some other commercial parcels that we're trying to build out, but I think, I really feel like the development it's moved along slower than we'd like, and we've gone through at least two recessions and a real estate bubble bursting in the process. But I'm really proud of the product, and I think people who go up there and look around, it's really it's also energy efficient, which I don't think people were thinking about when they were first doing this. We have neighborhoods up there that are going to be zero energy. Not actually putting, using any oil or gas. They're zero energy homes, and I think that's also been a plus as well.
Clare Higgins, your view of how it's turned out?
I would second all of that.
Buzz Chapman?
I think it's a good use of the property.
And Mary Ford, this was a continuing thorn in all of your sides for your entire terms. How to make this development happen? You satisfied with how this has turned out by and large?
On the whole.
Ooh, that sounded slightly qualified.
Physically, I would have liked to have every part a little bit more part of the village idea that we put forth, but some of the development has been closer to that than others. It's being used for walkability still. Yeah, and we've got a mix of incomes, and we've got some jobs and some space left to add more jobs. The other thing I hope sometime people can put in is either a dedicated space for the community, or a little neighborhood grocery store that would become a community place. Well,
which is part of the plan, yes?
It is, and it's part of the plan, although if you look at the original plan, there was also in the plan that we don't want to compete with downtown Northampton. So there's been that tension. You know, we're not trying to rebuild downtown Northampton at Village Hill. I will say that Christopher Heights, the new assisted living community that just opened its doors and people are living there, does have a community room that they're making available to everyone at Village Hill, including the Neighborhood Association. So that's one of the benefits of Christopher Heights.
I don't want to leave Dave Musante out of this. You're basically satisfied with how this has turned out?
Very, very slow. The first study up there cost $3,500, and and the big study, I think, was maybe $180,000 or $200,000, and was a replica of the first study.
Yeah.
They came in as a loss leader type thing, and they wanted the, but the state moves so slowly, it just takes time and time. Get on to another, on the other aspect. The Hotel Northampton, during my tenure, was going down. It was bankrupt, was about to be sold for public family housing. And most of you who know Northampton know that is a landmark in our city, and to lose that would have been terrible. Dick Colville took the leadership as president of NIS and got the five banks together along with Smith College to come up with money to put a down payment on purchasing the hotel. And they went out, this group, and found a preferred developer that would bring it back as a hotel, renovated the whole thing. And I think that was a real accomplishment. There was talk about political capital. I think it was Pat Goggins or someone when I was first starting my career. Pat, a longtime city councilor and county commissioner and one of the best political minds that I've found in a long while. I think it was he that told me that you build up political capital by doing popular things. But you're not worth your salt if you don't spend that political capital on things that are necessary and not popular. And the secret is to spend enough so that you get reelected or go on. But if you don't spend any, you're not doing the job for your city. That's kind of the way I feel.
We're going to be running out of time very quickly here, folks. This young fellow right here has been waiting for a long time. Step up to the mic.
Good afternoon. Now, my name's Roy Martin. I live here in the city. I've run for mayor several times. And I can remember back when I first come here, I was quite young then, right? And I can remember everyone going down behind the park smoking pot, right? A lot of them are not with us anymore. But, there's a lot to this.
Roy, you have a question? Do you have a question for us?
I didn't inhale them.
Do you have a question?
But yes, right, okay. Right, this here was the 10th city, right, Mr. Musante. Right, Mary Ford was the one that she got me interested in politics because she said to me, I need eyes in the city, and I went out there. And
are you going to run again?
Right, we're running out of time. We've got a question.
Okay, right. Mary Ford got me involved, right. Clare Higgins, I run against her every time that she run, right? You know, never successful, but always trying, right? Mayor Narkiewicz, I don't know. I haven't made a decision.
Roy, you got a question. A question?
Question, right? What are we going to do to bring more people to the city?
Okay, right? It's a question. Let's run down the...
I would say one of the most exciting things happening in Northampton right now is the number of new housing developments that are happening, and particularly in downtown Northampton, and some of it affordable, some of it for seniors. We have three major projects, two on the Pleasant Street corridor, one the reuse of St. John Cantius Church. I think the development at Village Hill, again, people wanting to live close to the core area of downtown. So I think this is an attractive place to live, and I think the projects that developers are bringing forward reflect that.
Mayor Clare Higgins?
I don't want to answer that question, all due respect to my opponent. But I just want to mention John Musante.
Oh, who, thank you for doing that.
You know, we all work with.
Thank you. Thank you for that.
A great loss, a great friend of the station.
And we all miss.
And our condolences to Mayor Musante. Before we go, we need to talk about the charter for just a minute. This is the first four-year term for Mayor Narkiewicz is the first four-year term. Let's ask somebody like Harry Chapman, for instance, if you had had a four-year term, do you feel that you could have accomplished everything that you set out to do? Is it a luxury?
No, I think it was desperately needed. One of the thoughts about when you leave office is I didn't get a chance to finish, and you would like that opportunity to do that. The voters thought differently, and so I ended the 2 years. But David and I talked about this when I was in visiting with him in May, and we came up with my family, and I think it was long overdue. Full-time mayor's position with the compensation that goes with that position is vital if you want to attract people of Dave's age and younger to that opportunity and position. But the ability to serve and to complete those things that were important when you ran, I think it's vital. And so I think it's probably the greatest thing the city did in terms of continuing and improving government.
We have just a couple minutes left. I would like to know from the rest of the mayors sitting here, do you all agree four-year terms actually is an improvement and important? Dave Musante?
We had some experts come in from the university and Amherst College back when I was mayor. We were considering a four-year term. What made sense to me, so with a two-year term, you're learning the job that first year, and the second year, you're running for re-election. So you don't get a hell of a lot accomplished. I think 4 years, I had 12, got a lot done, but anyone could get a lot done in 12 years. Harry had just two.
They a give 12-year me, term, Mayor Narkiewicz, what do
yes,
you think?
12, I have 12 years. Harry, we kid a lot, but he really got the grant monies for the downtown that I took credit for it because it got completed during my term. But he went out and got the grant monies, did a hell of a job.
We literally have a minute left. Mary Ford, you're in favor of the four-year term?
Yes.
Harry Chapman, you've told us. And Clare Higgins, you too.
I think there's a little bit lost, not around the four-year term, I supported around the councilor, the council having the mayor chairing the council. I think there's only something lost there in terms of the collegiality of city government. I don't think that's true now because David has a great relationship with the council. It'll be interesting to see what happens 20 years from now.
We're going to have to leave it there. Everybody, a big hand for our mayors, past and present.
We have to answer a question.
Mayor Narkiewicz, Mayor Chapman, Mayor Musante, Mayor Higgins, Mayor Ford. Thank you, Bill Newman. Thank you, Stan Moulton from the Gazette. Thank you, NCTV. And thanks, everybody, for showing up. Merry Christmas, happy holidays. And that's going to do it.